Good morning and welcome to Park Hill Baptist Church this morning. I'm Pastor Joseph, and the first thing I want to do is to remind our children and our adults our special handshake that we've learned to greet each other during this time when we're not able to touch or make physical contacts. So the first thing we do is this, and then we do this, and then this. So let's all do that one more time. So we do the big wave. Good job. All right, to begin today's service, we actually have the opportunity to have a baptism. So if you turn your attention to the baptistry, you should see me standing there. Good morning, everybody. And like I said in the video, we get to celebrate a baptism today, which is an absolutely awesome and amazing thing. We're going to be baptizing Ethan Garner. And I love this story because I got a call a couple weeks into quarantine, and Gina had called me and said, "Hey, Ethan has accepted Jesus as his Lord and Savior, and I just wanted to pass that along." And I think that that is a testament that even though we aren't able to gather together as a church body all the time, God is still working in our families. God is still working in our midst, and parents are continuing to work with their kids and lead their kids to Christ. And that is just awesome and amazing, one on our family's part, but also on God's part. So I just want us to reflect on that and remember that during this time when things are crazy, God is still working in our midst. At this point, I'm going to ask Ethan to come down and join me. I'm going to put my mask on because he's not wearing his since he's going underwater. So hopefully you'll still be able to hear me. All right. So this is Ethan, you want to wave and say hi to anybody? Ethan's got lots of family here with us, and that is wonderful. So, Ethan, I was telling everybody earlier that you had accepted Christ over quarantine. Is that true? Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Yes. Let's celebrate that real quick. All right, Ethan, since you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I'm now going to baptize you as my brother, buried with Christ, and raised to walk in the newness of life. All right. At this time, we are going to sing a song, and I think I've got some helpers who are going to come up to the stage. So if I can ask Miss Leah Grace and Miss Leona, if you guys want to come up to the stage and help us with our motions this week. Let's continue in worship.
Just as I am.
Just as I am.
Oh,
just as I am.
Oh,
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 oh.
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 Good morning, Park Hill family. You can be seated. Welcome. My name is Adam. I'm the pastor of youth discipleship here at Park Hill. Welcome to those who are watching online. Glad that you all are here with us today. And we're going to review our scripture verse from last week, which was Jeremiah 32, 17. And so if you memorize that, recite it with me out loud, or you can turn in your Bible and read it there as well. We need to work on that throughout the week. A couple of announcements for us. We just want to remind you that if you'd like to connect with a pastor, one way that you can do that is to text the words next steps, that's NXT steps, to the number 97000. Those of you watching online, you can do that as well. A pastor would be more than happy to meet with you and discuss whatever it is you would like to discuss. And one more reminder for us this morning. We'd like to thank you for all of your giving and supporting Park Hill Baptist Church. And we'd like to invite you to continue to do that. And there are a number of ways that you can do that on our way out this morning. If you're in the building, there's a box to my right, your left. As we're exiting, you can place your gift there, or you can send it in the mail to Park Hill Baptist Church, or you can just drop it by the church office upstairs, all right? Man, I'm glad to be worshiping with you guys this morning, and we're going to continue by watching a video from Pastor Joseph. Craig last week invited us and challenged us to share with each other what we've been learning, what God has been teaching us through this difficult season. And so Pastor Joseph has done just that, and we'll take a watch and listen to that right now.
Last week, Pastor Craig challenged us to think about what we have been learning during this time of COVID-19. So I just wanted to share with you what I've been learning. The big word for me has been flexibility. Now, some of you guys may not know this, but about 2 weeks before everything shut down, our staff had this really big planning session of everything that we were going to do over the rest of the year. We planned out events, sermon series, talked about all of our camps, just everything going on. And this was really great for me because I'm very much a detail-oriented person. Not great with spontaneity. Last-minute changes to plans just stress me out. So it was good to have all of this structured and set in a plan for all of this to happen. Now, obviously, none of this has gone according to plan. Basically, all of the events that we planned were thrown out the window. And we've just had to roll with the punches every step of the way and figuring out, what do we do during this time? And as a staff, we have continued to do that because our options were roll with the punches and figure out how to minister during this time, or give up and stop ministering. And obviously we aren't going to do that. So during this time, things have had to be a lot more flexible, making changes at the last minute because we don't know what tomorrow is going to look like. So while things have been stressful because they're not concrete, it's good to see that God is still able to work even when we don't have things completely planned and when we don't know what things are going to look like. Another aspect of that is dealing with the sadness of things that have been lost. We all have lost something during this time, and it may just be the sense of normality, or it may be just it may be something more significant, but we all have lost something. For instance, I'm an introvert, so honestly, I've enjoyed the months of solitude that we've been able to have, but some of the big losses for me were realizing that we weren't going to be able to have our Park Hill Kids Camp, the biggest outreach that our children's ministry does every year, and that we weren't able to go to our Bog Springs summer camp. We were supposed to be at that camp this past week. Realizing that we weren't going to get to do those things and the kids weren't going to be able to have those opportunities was a loss for me. So in those moments that I'm saddened by that, I can either reject those emotions and push them down, or I can acknowledge them, respond to them, and express as I need to, and allow God to work through those emotions and remind me again that even though we're not able to do things as we planned, He is still working throughout this time. So that is just a small segment of what I've been learning during this time, but I hope it has been encouraging to you.
All right, let's stand together and worship in song. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, the walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Raise the mountain, fix the plummet.
Glad to be here with you. My name's Craig. I'm the senior pastor here, and just excited to be with you in person this morning. That wasn't Rona. Allergies. So if you would, open with me in your Bibles to 1 Kings. 1 Kings. We're beginning a new series today, and we'll talk about that in just a second. But before we do that, I want to welcome you who are here, and for those of you who are online, we're glad that you're worshiping with us today, and can't wait to see everyone in person in the near future. So hopefully we can do that pretty soon. So, and if you're viewing this later, and we know for a lot of people, the first time you visit a church is online. You'll visit through the website, and we just want to greet you and say we'd love to see you someday and be able to meet you. So our mission as a church has not changed one bit since the corona thing started happening. Our mission is the same as it was 2,000 years ago, which is go and make disciples and to become disciples, right? To share the gospel, to teach and train what it means to follow Jesus, to reproduce our faith in other people. Our mission has not changed, but the process, what that looks like, has changed a little bit, hasn't it? But I want to assure you that as a church, our mission is the exact same. And so we're praying about it, and I want to invite you to pray with us about how we can continue to reach people with the good news of the gospel, how we can continue to make disciples in this uncertain season, because our mission cannot change. And so let's continue to pray through that and think through what God would have us to do as a church family. So let me pray for us, and then we're going to dive into this new series, which I think is going to be a lot of fun and hopefully convicting. I hope that it really brings us to a point of being able to meet Jesus in a fresh way. So let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you are here, that you're with us, and that you continue to challenge us to grow. Lord, I pray that you would give us wisdom and help us to see you. Lord, I pray that with all the distractions that are happening in the world right now, I pray for the next 20 minutes, God, you would give us the ability to hear from you, to stay focused on you. So, Lord, we love you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So Tim Keller, who's a pastor in New York, wrote this, speaking about idols. He says, we do not lie or fail to love or break our promises or live, or why do we lie, excuse me, or fail to love or break our promises or live selfishly? Of course, the general answer is because we are weak and sinful. But the specific answer is that there is something besides Jesus Christ that we feel we must have to be happy, something that is more important to our heart than God, something that is enslaving our heart through inordinate desires. Idolatry is the default setting of your heart. It's the default setting of my heart. And all of us, each and every one of us, have eyes for idols. We're drawn to them. They catch our eye. Have you ever been laying in bed and you're looking up at a white ceiling and you see like a black spot or a fly or something? It just stands out to you. You just get that off there. Our eyes are drawn to things that aren't supposed to be there. And idols are the same way. Our eyes get drawn to the things that are the shiniest, the most exciting. In a lot of ways, we're like a cat. Our family just got a cat, a little kitten. And I didn't think, Chandra, I didn't think I was a cat person. Is she here today? But I am. I'm a cat person. I've given you a hard time, and I need to repent of that. I love this little thing. But it is the most distractible little thing you've ever met. Like shiny, it's out, right? Anything glowing or making noise, it is on it. But that is our eyes. That's how we are drawn to idols. Now, all of us have our own idols. Every single one of us have our idols of preference. And so because it's our default setting, our hearts, though we desire to serve God, are steered by some unholy leash every time back to the idol of our choosing. And so each of us has to wrestle with, what are the idols of my heart? In the Old Testament, we see that idols were often pictured as statues or these sort of relics or temples that people would go and worship at. But now we're much more sophisticated, aren't we? We don't go to temples. Our idols tend to live in the quiet. They tend to live inside. When Jesus steps into your life, all those idols tend to scurry and run away, but they don't leave. They just go underground. They go into hiding. It's kind of like walking into a room where there's a bunch of cockroaches and flipping the light off. They all scurry behind the walls. See, the Christian life, Jesus is like when Jesus comes into your life, it's flipping on the light, and all of a sudden now God is present in your life, but all those idols have been scurrying. And now the rest of our life in Christ is meant tearing down walls, looking behind benches, trying to figure out, where are all these idols at? Where have they gone? So that we can remove them. And so for you and I, the struggle is not so much, are we going to be able to find them, but what do we do with them when we find them? God requires us as children to die daily, die to ourselves daily, take up our cross so that we may experience his life. But an idol invites us to be ardent worshipers of this new life that they can promise, and yet they only lead to death. So Christ says, die to self so you may live. The idol says, live for yourself and live for me, but they only can give death. And so as a pastor, my job, one of my primary job descriptions, is to point out idols and help all of us begin to step away from those idols and begin to walk in Christ. So idols can take a lot of different forms. They can take the form of sex and power and wealth. For many people, they'll take the form of happiness, wanting to be happy, wanting to be at peace with everyone. Perfection can be an idol. Control, power can be an idol. Wanting to make sure that I am in control. All those things can be idols. But how would anyone, why would anyone follow an idol? Why do we do that? Well, there's no easy answer, but the most simple answer is control. Idols promise a perverted and deceptive sense of mastery. This is what was happening in Scripture, right? For example, if you wanted it to rain, you wanted your produce to grow, your farm to do well, you might choose an idol, a god that was in charge of the weather, which we'll look at one, a god like that, next week. So you would choose a god that's over the weather. If you wanted to have a large family, you would choose a god that was over fertility. You wanted to be in control, so you would choose a god based on what you wanted to control at that moment. And if we translate that into our day-to-day life now, we still want to be in control. And so we will choose gods of our choosing. We want to be happy, so we're going to make sure that we do the things. We please the happy gods. whatever the culture says will make us happy, we do those things in order to gain happiness. We want to feel fulfilled. Then we go to the culture and we say, okay, what is the God of fulfillment? And then we give ourselves over completely to that. And so many of these gods work behind the scenes. But it is idolatry and it is a heart. But for all of us, don't think that I'm just pointing the finger at you. All of us have these idols of the heart. And all of us need to wrestle with them. So as followers of Jesus, we give up control. We give up the ability to control the weather. We give up the ability to control coronavirus. We give up the ability to control all these things. And we place them firmly in the hands of a loving Father. And we say, I'm not going to go to idols for these answers. I'm just going to come to you. I'm not going to worry about my popularity or how happy I am or how much people like me. I'm going to place those in your hands. Now, this is the work of a lifetime, right? This is not a sermon series and we're done. We checked out idols. Check the box. Idols are gone. Now there's nothing left. That's just not how it works. This is the work that you're involved with for the rest of your life, is uncovering these idols of the heart so that you can begin to be free. And that's ultimately what this work is about. It's about freedom. I've heard a lot about freedom on social media and the news over the last several weeks, but let me tell you what true freedom is. True freedom is not being able to make all the decisions that you want to make about your own life. That is a form of freedom, but true freedom is being free of idolatry. True freedom is not having any idols of the heart that control you or manipulate you or try to move you in a certain direction, but it is freedom in Christ. And so if you want to be free, you want to be truly free, then this is the work that you must do. It is the heart work. It is the idol work that every single one of us are engaged with. But sadly, for many believers, these idols sort of run under the surface and we're never even aware of their presence. And so that's my challenge. Over the next several weeks, we're going to be looking at the life of Elijah. We're going to be asking the question, Elijah, how do you deal with idols? What should we do? And we're going to let the story of Elijah from 1 and 2 Kings inform how we deal with our idols. But before we get to Elijah, we need to kind of understand the backstory. And the backstory begins in the first part of 1 Kings with a king by the name of Solomon. Now, Solomon was the son of David. And David was a great king. He made a lot of mistakes. But the Bible says that David was a king or a man after God's own heart. I mean, he sinned, but he repented. He messed up, but he came back to God. But as a result of one of the big mistakes that David made, a blessing was given to him, and it was Solomon. And Solomon, though he wasn't the oldest, in fact, he was probably a teenager whenever he became king. Though he wasn't the oldest, he wasn't the smartest, he wasn't the most mature, David, through God's providence, said Solomon will be king. And so Solomon assumes the throne. And Solomon goes in 1 Kings chapter 3. I'm going to skip around a little bit, so if you want to flip with me, you can, or if you just want to listen, that'll be fine as well. So in 1 Kings chapter 3, Solomon made an alliance with the Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to marry Pharaoh's daughter. Which seems innocent enough for a king to marry a foreign, you know, king's daughter. You make alliances. This is how kingdoms were built. But that's foreshadowing for what's ultimately going to happen in Solomon's life. Now, at this time, Solomon is still wanting to follow the Lord. He's still wanting to walk with God. So he marries this woman. Solomon brought her to the city of David until he finished building his palace, the Lord's temple. And the wall surrounding Jerusalem. However, the people were sacrificing on the high places because until that time, the temple for the Lord's name had not yet been built. So let me just pause there. So remember, the nation of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, God gave them the promised land. And they go into the promised land, and the Canaanites were there. And the Canaanites had these places of worship called high places, basically because they were usually up on a hill or up on a mountain. They were higher than normal, and so they would go up to the high places to worship. Now, we know that there were some high places that were down in valleys, but in general, the high places were up high. And so they would go to these high places to worship. And so when Israel came through and the Canaanites spread out, many of the Jewish people, as they settled down into those areas, would just adopt those high places. They would clear out the false gods, and they would make it a place of worship to Yahweh. And so they had these high places that were there. But there were many times whenever a lot of those Canaanite cultures would remain, and some of those high places were polluted with false gods. They were polluted with false practices. Some of them were pure, some of them weren't. Some of them still had false gods attached to them, some of them didn't. So the high places were sort of a mixed bag. But that was the only place that they had to worship, because there was not yet a temple been built. And so Solomon goes to these high places to worship God. And scripture at this point doesn't say anything bad about that. That was just where he could go. But it says that because there was not yet a temple, this was all that they had. But that was about to change. Because in verse 3, Solomon loved the Lord by walking in the statutes of his father David, but he also sacrificed and burnt incense on the high places. So we see that there's this tinge of foreshadowing. That Solomon, though he loved the Lord and he loved his father David, he was still willing to go to the high places where he could be polluted, where he might allow an idol to trickle into his worship. Solomon goes to God, or God comes to Solomon in a dream before the temple is built, and God asks Solomon, "Solomon, what do you want me to give you? You're king over my people. What do you want?" And Solomon says, I don't want money. I don't want power. I want wisdom to govern your people well." Remember, Solomon was probably a teenager at this point. He says, "I just need wisdom." And God says to him in a dream, "Well, because you've not asked for money or power or any of those things, you've asked for wisdom to govern my people well. I will give you wisdom and I will give you money and power. You'll be wealthy and you'll be the most powerful man on the earth." And that's what we see in the life of Solomon, that he begins this incredible life of wealth and wisdom and power. People from all over the world begin to flock to him because of what this wisdom that God has given him. I mean, he is walking step by step with the Lord. In fact, we have books of the Bible written by Solomon, and his wisdom and his willingness to follow after God. Little did Solomon know there was an idol lurking under the surface. So Solomon continues to walk with the Lord. So Solomon built a temple for God. If you flip to the 1 Kings chapter 8, Solomon builds this temple, this centralized place of worship that God has given him the instructions. He's told him how to build it. And he says, "This is where I will meet with my people. I'll no longer meet with them in the high places. I'll no longer meet with them. I'm going to meet with them here in this temple." They bring the Ark of the Covenant into the temple. God is there. And Solomon prays a prayer over the temple after it's completed there in verse 12. "Then Solomon said, 'The Lord said he would dwell in total darkness, and I have indeed built an exalted temple for you, a place for your dwelling forever.' And the king turned around and blessed the entire congregation of Israel while they were standing." He said, and listen to this, I'm going to read this passage because I think it's important. He says, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. He spoke directly to my father David, and he has fulfilled the promise by his power. He said, 'Since the day I brought my people Israel out of Egypt, I have not chosen a city to build a temple in among any of the tribes of Israel so that my name would be there. But I have chosen David to rule to rule my people Israel. My father David has had his heart set on building a temple for the name of the Lord, the God of Israel. But the Lord said to my father David, 'Since your heart was set on building the temple for my name, you have done well to have this desire. Yet you are not the one to build it. Instead, your son, your own offspring, will build it for me. The Lord has fulfilled what he promised. I have taken the place of my father David, and I sit on the throne of Israel. As the Lord promised, I have built the temple for the name of the Lord, the God of Israel. I have provided a place for the ark, where the Lord's covenant is that he made with our ancestors when he brought them out of the land of Egypt." And so Solomon has built this temple, this place of worship, where now God is going to meet with his people. And if we continue to read in 1 Kings, and I would invite you to do this, that after Solomon prays a blessing on the temple, the presence of God, the Shekinah glory of God, falls on the temple, fills that space, and now God's dwelling is with his people. This temple, this place, is where God will meet with his people. And so God is defining the terms. This is what worship is going to look like. This is how you will worship. This is where you will worship. God is defining the terms of worship. Why? Why is God centralizing this place of worship here in the temple? Well, it's because of all the high places. Because the people keep drifting away from the Lord. And so God is saying, no, I'm going to centralize this. I want you to see it. I want you to know it. I don't want you to drift off into idols. I want you to worship me the way that I tell you to worship, how I want you to worship, and when I want you to worship, because I know your heart will drift. I know your heart will begin to long after other gods. Why? Because of control. You see, our God is not a God who can be controlled. He is not a God that simply responds to us whenever we say a certain prayer or make a certain chant or offer a certain sacrifice. That is not how God works. God cannot be controlled. He is loving and he is good, but you are not in control of him. But idols? Idols can be controlled. At least the perception of control. So our hearts begin to drift. If you flip over to 1 Kings 11. So Solomon has built this temple to God. And we read in chapter 10 of Solomon's great wisdom and his great wealth. And we read of his many wives as he began to marry people from, marry the daughters of kings from all different nations. But Solomon had an idol. And it's hard to say exactly what his idol was, but one of his idols may have been the pleasing his wives, making sure they were happy. Made him feel happy if they were happy. If they loved him, then he felt loved. And so he wanted to give them whatever they wanted. And so one of the things that he does is he builds the high places back. This is the man who built the temple for the living God in Jerusalem, and now he will erect the high places, not just for God, but for idols. Chapter 11, King Solomon loved many foreign women in addition to Pharaoh's daughter, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonite, and Hittite women from the nations about which the Lord had told the Israelites, you must not intermarry with them, and they must not intermarry with you, because they will turn your heart away to follow their gods. To these women, Solomon was deeply attached in love. We had seen he had 700 wives who were princesses and 300 who were concubines, and they turned his heart away. That is a tragic statement. A man who had met with God, who had received the wisdom of God, who had built the temple for God, his heart was led astray. And notice that it wasn't his wives that were the problem. It was his heart. He loved, he desired something more than his God. And so his heart was turned away. Verse 4, when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away to follow other gods. He was not wholeheartedly devoted to the Lord his God as his father David had been. Solomon followed Ashtoreth, which was a false god, the goddess of the Sidonites, and Milcom, the abhorrent idol of the Ammonites. Solomon did what was evil in the Lord's sight, and unlike his father David, he did not remain loyal to the Lord. And tragically, in verse 7, at that time, Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abhorrent idol of the Moab and the Milcom, the abhorrent idol of the Ammonites on the hill across from Jerusalem. He did the same for all his foreign wives who were burning incense and offering sacrifices to their gods. Across the hill from the temple of the living God stands a high place of worship to a false god. And this false god in particular was known as the conqueror or the subduer. Can you imagine putting a god who is the conqueror opposed to the God of Israel, the Lord of armies? And so we have these two opposing gods. And in verse 9, God pronounces judgment on Solomon. The Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice. He had commanded him about this so that he would not follow other gods, but Solomon did not do what the Lord had commanded. Then the Lord said to Solomon, "Since you have done this and did not keep my covenant and my statutes, which I commanded you, I will tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. However, I will not do it in your lifetime for the sake of your father David. I will tear it out of your son's hand, yet I will not tear the entire kingdom away from him. I will give him one tribe to your son for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem that I chose." And so, because of Solomon's heart, this kingdom that God had built, that he had given to Solomon, is now going to be divided. We read about this in the second book of Kings and in Chronicles, where there's actually a civil war that takes place in Jerusalem. There's a north and a south. There's a division of the kingdom. Judah, which will remain with Solomon, and then Israel. So we have Judah and Israel. And now these two nations are going to follow completely different paths. What was once one nation is now two. And Judah, the nation of Judah, will have a few good kings, but mostly bad. The nation of Israel will have all bad kings, all following after false gods. And God, ultimately, what will happen is because of their rebellion and their unwillingness to follow him, will ultimately send Babylon and the Chaldeans to judge them and take them into captivity so that they will learn to follow only him. And so what ends up happening at the end of 2 Kings, if you flip, 1 and 2 Kings are like one book written over two different, broken up into two different parts. But if you flip to the end of 2 Kings in chapter 25, and before we get to kind of this time period, we read in the book of Jeremiah in chapter 2, speaking about the same time period just before we get to the end of 2 Kings. So Jeremiah was kind of in that same time period. He said that the nation of Israel had as many idols as there were cities, that they had completely divested themselves of the Lord and they were only serving these idols. But in 2 Kings chapter 25 verses 8 and 9, we read this tragic statement that on the seventh day of the fifth month, which was the 19th year of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, the captain of the guards, a servant of the king of Babylon, entered Jerusalem. The captain of the guards, a servant of the king of Babylon, entered Jerusalem. And listen to what he did. He burned the Lord's temple, the king's palace, and all the houses of Jerusalem. He burned down all the great houses. Everything that Solomon had built burned to the ground. Why? Because his heart was led astray. What Solomon did hundreds of years prior resulted in 588, the destruction of the temple that he had built. His heart led astray, the nation led astray, judgment takes place. It says, the king entered and he burned. This is always the end result of idolatry. The enemy enters and he burns. Wherever you have erected a high place in your life, wherever you have said, this is a place where I will worship, this is a place where I will be happy, this is a place where I will receive fulfillment or whatever, wherever you erect those things, eventually the enemy will enter and burn. It will never result in what you hope it will result in. You see, God is a jealous God. He wants your whole heart. But listen, he is not codependent. He is not going to say, well, you know, I really wish you would love me. And since, even though you're not, I'm still going to do some things for you just so that maybe you'll come back and I'm just going to continue to be here. And you know, eventually God just judges his people and says he pours discipline out on them so they will turn from their wicked ways. And he's doing it from a place of love and of grace. He is not some weakling God. No, he is a jealous God who wants your heart. But he will not play second fiddle. If you're going to follow after false gods, if you're going to let your heart be led astray, God will let you follow it. He will not be second fiddle, but he will call to you. He will woo you. He will be there whenever you're ready to return with arms full of grace and love, but he will not be second fiddle in your life. And so everywhere that we identify an idol, we must crush it and be freed from it. So what's our walkaway truth this morning? Idolatry at its core is a heart issue and a boundary issue. As in, God never intended for you to control that, whatever that thing is. Idolatry at its core is a heart issue and a boundary issue. What do you mean by a boundary issue? I think we understand what a heart issue is. It's something that we desire. A boundary issue is God says, don't cross this line, and we do it anyway. Don't control this, but we try to control it anyway. Don't go here. Don't do that. And this was the issue in the Garden of Eden, right? God said, don't eat of this tree. You can have all the other trees. Don't eat of this tree. And they said, well, we want to eat of that tree. It's a boundary issue. God says no. We said, are you sure? And so idolatry is about trying to control things that God never wanted us to control to begin with. Idolatry is about trying to be more than who God has made us to be, which is human beings who are dependent on him. Idolatry is a heart issue and a boundary issue. And so for us, our boundary issues are often taking place within our own heart, in the private side of life, because we know how to put up a good front. We know how to show everyone our non-idolatrous side, don't we? But in the recesses, there are idols. So our one small step this morning, if we're going to take a step forward and grow in this, we need to tear down the high places of our life. Tear down the high places of our life. For you and I, we need to find those private areas of worship to false gods. The ones that drive our desire, that drive our ego, that make us feel like we're so important or that we're loved. Anything that is not falling at the feet of Jesus and receiving from him the love and grace that we need to then serve the world around us. That is an idol. And guess what? All of us are chock full of them. There's not one of us that just has millions and one only has a few. No, all of us are full of idols because we live in a fallen and broken world. But thankfully, Jesus, by what he did on the cross, made a way for us to overcome those idols. To find a way forward in our worship of the one true God. To allow our hearts not to be led astray. So just like the Israelites, some of those high places we build for ourselves, and some of those high places were built by a culture long before we got here, and we've just sort of adopted them. So some of our idols we've chosen. Some of them were chosen for us. Some of them were passed on by your family of origin. They gave, here's some high places that you'll worship at, and you just said, yes, ma'am, yes, sir, this will work for me. Some of them have been given by culture. Some of them you've adopted from friends. Some of them you've married someone that has given you a high place that you'll worship at. All of us adopt and receive high places of worship, and it is our responsibility as followers of Christ to tear them down. The image of God in his temple as a central place of worship and devotion is the key part of this story. God is not in a physical temple, but he lives in the heart of his people. We are the temple of God. That is now the battleground. So Solomon places a false god on a hill across from the temple. Well, guess what? There is a false god across the hill in the temple of your heart. The battleground is not over land. The battleground is over your soul at this point. And the question isn't, will I get to heaven when I die? The question is, who will rule my heart while I live? So it's not enough for us just to simply say Jesus lives in my heart, but does warrior Jesus, who is at work in you, is he going from place to place in your heart, tearing down the high places? That's the work. So as a part of a church email that's going to go out tomorrow, I'm including 20 questions that I borrowed from a book from Tim Keller, who I quoted at the beginning of the sermon, called Counterfeit Gods, where he lists out 20 questions that will help you identify private idols in your life. I think if you're watching online, they're going to drop that in the chat just now so that you can take a look at that. So, but let me just read through a few of these. I'm not going to read all 20 just for the sake of time, but basically, here's how we respond. Life only has meaning, or I only have worth if, here's the first one, I have power and influence over others. It's a power idolatry. I have meaning, or I only have worth if I'm loved and respected by blank, approval idolatry. Life only has meaning, I only have worth if I have this kind of pleasure experience, a particular quality of life, a comfort idol. I'm able to get mastery of my life over this area, a control idol. People are dependent on me and need me, a helping idol. I'm adhering to my religion's moral codes and accomplished in its activities, a religion idol. My race and culture are ascendant and recognized as superior, a racial or cultural idol. My children and my parents are happy and happy with me, a family idol. I have a particular kind of look or body image, an image idol. And in the list, there are several more. Our idols take many different forms. And what lures your heart will not lure mine. And what lures mine may not lure yours. But all of us have the same work. All of us have the same battle. And that is, just like Solomon, that though we may want to erect a temple for God in our own hearts, a temple that Jesus himself purchased on the cross, if we are not careful, our hearts will be led astray to false idols. If we do not guard our hearts, because from them flow the streams of life, if we do not guard our hearts, we may be led to false idols. I'm not saying you'll start bowing down and worshiping another god, but the desires of your heart will lead you astray. So as we wrap up, imagine with me that you're not just avoiding idols publicly, but also becoming extremely aware of the idols of your heart. Imagine a few years from now, not only are you living out your life in Christ, but you begin to notice a freedom in your spirit that you've never experienced before. Because you've begun to wrestle with these idols, you've begun to figure out what it takes by the Holy Spirit and through prayer and through Scripture and the community of believers, what it means to tap down and defeat idols, and you begin to become more free to love yourself, more free to love God, more free to love other people. You become so free that all of a sudden you begin to think, God, this is what you meant by I am the life. You begin to become so free that you begin to realize Jesus wasn't just here to get me to heaven. He was here to give me life today, to transform my life into something brand new. That's the kind of freedom that Christ wants to give to you. And I encourage you this morning to begin that journey. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we give this time to you. And we ask that in your name, that idols would be crushed. That we would no longer be content with idols being erected in our heart. Lord, over the next several weeks, we're going to talk about how we identify them, how we destroy them, how we walk in your faith, in your presence, even while they're there. What does it look like for us to be the people of God who have idols, whose hearts have been led astray? So, Lord, we thank you, and we give this time to you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
What a great reminder. Okay, we are about to dismiss, but before we do, we have a new scripture memory verse for us all. I'm going to turn there now to 1 Kings 18, verse 32. Verse 32 of chapter 18. 1 Kings. It reads this way. And he built an altar with the stones in the name of the Lord. Then he made a trench around the altar large enough to hold about 4 gallons. That's not right. Is it 2 Kings, maybe? Sorry. 1 Kings 8:32-23. That was all kinds of wrong. Let's go build a trench. Okay, 8:23. There it is. Boom. All right. Let's read it together. He said, Lord God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth below, who keeps the gracious covenant with your servants who walk before you with all their heart. 1 Kings 8:23. That's better. Okay, if you've been watching with us online, we've been so glad that you've been here with us. And so we will see you next week. All right. Dismiss. And so we're going to do that.